Welcome to Constellations, the podcast from Kratos, where industry leaders share their thoughts and experience on the future of space business, policy, and opportunity. If you like Constellations, please support us by giving a rating and review on iTunes. And don't forget to share this podcast online to help our community grow.
Welcome to Constellations, the podcast from Kratos. My name is John Gilroy, and I'll be your moderator. Our guest today is Alexander Vallée, Chief of the Space Services Department in the Radio Communication Bureau of the International Telecommunications Union, the ITU. Today, we will discuss the regulatory implications of the exponential growth in small satellites. More than 8,500 satellites are projected to be launched between 2019 and 2028, according to Euroconsult. With so much growth on the horizon, regulatory efforts will be challenged to keep pace. Many key questions will need to be answered. What role will regulatory efforts play in terms of protecting the spectrum, helping to avoid interference, and ensuring a level playing field for new and incumbent players? With us today to shed some light on these topics is Alexander Vallée, the Chief of the Space Services Department in the Radio Communication Bureau of the ITU. Alexander will share his insights on the role of regulation in the rapidly growing and evolving new space world. Alexander, how are you?
Thank you, Al. Thank you for the invitation.
Good. You know, with so much rapid technological development in the satellite industry, how's that affecting the role and the pace of policy from the International Telecommunications Union?
Well, in fact, the ITU is quite well positioned because we have a quite unique way to manage international policy among the United Nations systems. We are one of the small and number of agencies that have a way to manage treaties with frequent review of them. So we review our treaties managing the radio spectrum every 4 years, which allows us to keep pace with the technological development. Noting as well that one of the requests from the companies that are innovating is also that there is a kind of stability in the regulations, because if regulations change too often, then there is no way for them to use their innovation, to put their innovation on the market and benefit from the innovation they have invented. So there is a subtle balance to find between the change in the treaty and the stability that are needed by the industrial base to be able to put in the market innovation in a legal certainty.
So to use a sports analogy here, it's kind of a level playing field you try to achieve with this balance. Is that right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Good, good. So what are the specific regulatory challenges posed by these mega constellations out there?
Well, in fact, the main principle that we rely upon, which is a cooperation between member states to find solutions to share the same radio spectrum and orbit resources, will remain valid with mega constellation. However, there will be a big change in the field of the complexity of the interference computation. If you wish, our system is based on the idea that if you have a satellite project, whether a GSO or non-GSO, what you will do is that you will publish it in ITU, and you will coordinate, you will negotiate with other projects to be sure that you don't interfere with the operation of other projects. Up to now, these negotiations were quite easy technically, in the sense that it was mainly some C/I computations done in quite static environment. For example, two GSO networks, they are very static links. Now, the big challenge is that with mega constellations, you need to model these constellations, and you need to compute the statistics of interference produced by each of them. So when the constellations are small, the increased complexity is not so large and it's manageable. With the advent of really mega constellations, then the complexity is going up, and therefore the need for more accurate and more efficient way of computing interference is now also starting to appear.
You know, it used to be you would manage thousands of constellations. Now you're going to manage potentially tens of thousands of constellations. Got to wonder if the old model will still be able to expand to that different scale.
Well, first, there is an important point, I think, to in mind is that not all the projects that are on the paper or on the table will eventually come to fruition and will be launched.
Yeah.
So there is a lot of ideas proposed, but not all of them, I think, will ever be used. So the level of the number of satellites that are going to be operated is probably going to be smaller than the ones that are currently discussed in the press or in the announcement from companies. This being said, you're right that the number of satellites that are ultimately going to be orbiting the Earth is going to significantly increase. But the main things to remember is that the negotiations and the management of this interference are really between the operators, not so much between the satellites themselves. And the number of satellite operators may not be so high. So in my view, the interference will remain manageable because the number of players that will operate such constellation will remain quite limited in a specific frequency.
That makes perfect sense to me. You know, popular word in this community is CubeSats and small satellites, small sats, very popular. Can they get to access the radio spectrum resources in a practical manner?
The answer is yes, provided that they accept to devote a little bit of time to reading the regulations, how to get access to these resources, and also provided they accept to plan a little bit in advance in the project. This aspect of this project, because I often meet with SMEs or universities that found that getting access to frequency resources is long. Then I ask them, okay, so what is when have you started your project? And some university says, oh, we have started 5 years ago, but we have not decided to ask for any frequencies until we have finished the building and the manufacturing of satellites. The problem is that it's a little bit too late to call to ask for frequencies when you have finished the construction of your satellite.
Yeah.
You should do it a little bit before in your process, in your project, so that it's one of the numerous aspects of the project you should manage. And in my personal view, my encouragement at least is that as soon as you start manufacturing a satellite, then you should also start asking for frequencies. And then you have perfect time to build to get your frequency in time for your satellite to be launched.
You know, in the United States, the marketing people have this phrase, first mover advantage. And I think this may apply to your world as well. Is there some room available in the geostationary arc for new entrants?
Well, the first thing to remember is that when you speak about the GSO arcs, it's important not to speak about it only in terms of orbital locations, but as a couple of orbital location and frequency available. Because if you only look at the one side of the coin, it may look not so nice, but if you look to the two-dimensional aspects, frequency and orbital location, yes, definitely, there are still room. Of course, going in higher frequencies, C-band and Ku-band now are very much used. There is not a lot of room available yet C and Ku. But if you go in higher frequency bands, yes, there are still some rooms. Another part that is interesting to note and to see that it fits with the current trend is that there are rooms in C, even in C and Ku-band, there are rooms for some small GSOs. That is to say, if you try to find an orbital position on the GSO arc where you want to use the entire Ku-band spectrum, it's probably going to be very difficult. But if you want to use part of the Ku-band spectrum over a certain limited area with a small GSO, for example, then you open up a lot more opportunities. And I have noted, for example, that there is some ideas of now having small platform in GSOs that would not try to use so many transponders or so many frequencies as the traditional big GSOs, but we really focus on a specific market. And this, the advent of this new kind of GSO is interesting also because it fits very well with the remaining part of the spectrum and orbit resources that are available in KU or in CBEL.
Yeah. You know, recently there was news in the last couple of weeks about a possible collision that almost happened up in the sky. You know, LEO orbit congestion can only be avoided, or at least limited, by end-of-life deorbiting policy. And so what is the role of the ITU, and can such a policy be enforced?
Well, strictly speaking, the ITU is not responsible for the aspect of the satellite life, I would say, because this is purely a physical aspect of the satellite life, and the ITU deals with the use of frequencies by satellite. This being said, we have noticed that most of the actors now are interested in the topics and agree that tighter rules are necessary. The enforcement of them is, in my view, mainly a national issue, and it's probably up to each nation to start enforcing such rules. Up to now, we have seen that there is a lot of discussions to find the right balance between the sustainability of the space environment and the economic burden on the space companies. But I hope that more conclusions will be drawn up in the next 2 years, and we'll start to see some national implementation on this aspect. And, you know, it's not so much that we need a lot of countries to start enforcing such rules. If we start with two or three leading countries, then a lot of others will follow, and then it will be a virtuous cycle.
Oh, that makes sense. You know, earlier in the interview, we talked about a level playing field. So, Alexander, how can you ensure equitable access to the radio spectrum with so many constellations out there? I see all kinds of press releases.
Yeah. Well, as I mentioned before, it's important to distinguish between the press releases and the actual implementation.
Yeah.
There will definitely be either consolidation or some project not being able to be financed. This being said, how to ensure equitable access with constellations? The fact is that contrary to the GSO satellites, which have a very static interference environment, constellations also bring with them a lot of flexibility in operational terms, because if you have many satellites in view, you can choose the one that is less interfering with the other constellations. You are not necessarily forced to choose the one that creates an interference problem. So that's something that the kind of flexibility you don't have in GSO. And this is, in my view, the point that will make possible for many constellations to coexist, is that constellations bear with them inherent flexibilities.
Well, I never thought of it from a flexibility perspective, but it makes sense, doesn't it? You have options and choices there you may not have earlier.
Yeah, the only thing is that you will have to accept some of these operational flexibilities that maybe you wanted to design to maximize your cash flow.
Yeah.
You will have to take a part of it to also share with the others and coexist with others. But it's probably the inevitable way to ensure coexistence.
Yeah. You know, Alexander, thousands of people from all over the world have listened to this podcast. If you're listening now, go to Google and type in Constellations Podcast to get to our show notes page. Here you can get transcripts of all of our 67 interviews. Also, you can sign up for free email notifications for future podcasts with well-known gentlemen like Alexander here. Another question for you. You've got a good perspective on this. What kind of trends do you see, and what are you seeing in the interference cases affecting satellite systems today?
Well, the good news is that we see less and less politically motivated interference cases. Definitely in the last 5 years, these cases have significantly decreased. The bad thing, I would say, is that we see more and more piracy events. Piracy in the sense that some companies or some Earth Station users monitors empty parts of satellite transponders and try to use them without buying them.
Yeah.
This may be quite crude. Simply, you monitor and you use, but this may sometimes involve a more subtle and elaborated way. For example, the piracy is made by an intermediate company that in fact sell capacity that they don't own to people, for example, SNG users, that legitimately pay and believe that they own the right to use the capacity, but start to use it. And then the satellite operator discover that it seems to be pirate, but when they contact them, discover that they have paid something. Yeah. And that they were of good faith trying to use the satellite. So the piracy can be also the intermediate. And this kind of events definitely needs a little bit more enforcement and more attention. This is a very, kind of case that is linked with transparent bandpipe satellites. You can't do that with an HTS satellite and because you cannot monitor what part of the spectrum is empty. Then the other trend that we noticed is the increase of terrestrial interference into satellite reception, mainly in the lower part of the band, in L-band or S-band. This, we have more and more cases.
Well, earlier we talked about LEO orbit congestion. Let's talk about MEO here, too. What do you think the impact of new satellite constellations such as LEOs and MEOs will have on an interference standpoint?
Well, I think it will completely redefine the nature of what we call acceptable interference. So we always have some small interference events in satellite communications. But up to now, if you wish, in a GSO environment, GSO versus GSO, your link is interfered or is not interfered. It's very black and white. Yeah. Either you are completely interfered or you are not.
Yeah.
With non-GSO systems, it is going to be much more subtle in the sense that you are not going to be interfered 100% of the time, for sure, because the moving aspects of the satellite will make sure that this will be a statistical interference. Then the question is what kind of metrics and what kind of criteria are going to be used to define acceptable interference in terms of percentage of time, but also length of the interference events. Maybe it's acceptable to be interfered 10 seconds every 1 month, or maybe for the systems it will be 1 second every 1 day, yeah. Things like that. And to be honest, there is currently a lot of theoretical documentation on that. But I think with the advent of real constellation in orbit, we will see, we'll have feedback from operational teams that will really be able to cross-check with theoretical parameters to determine what are really the acceptable interference in a LEO environment or MEO environment.
Yeah. Let's talk a little bit about the C-band spectrum now. You know, satellite and 5G are squaring off for the available C-band spectrum with some conflicts. Knowing that a number of countries still run emergency services on C-band, how is the ITU trying to settle that dispute?
Well, first of all, the World Radio Conferences have identified the lower part of C-band as a potential part for deploying 5G networks or mobile networks. Therefore, the stronger encouragement is to start with this lower part of C-band before going to up. Then some countries need to use more mobile spectrum upward. And generally, these countries are also those that do not need so much satellite links. Mm-hmm. So what we do is that we emphasize the fact that it's really a national decision based on national consideration and needs. There is not one size fits all. It really depends on how much spectrum you need for mobile, how much spectrum you need for satellite, and we believe that there is no reason why there is not enough spectrum for both kind of usage.
Wow. Very optimistic. A trending word here in the United States is the word hybrid. And hybrid networks will make it more difficult to distinguish space from terrestrial networks and associated providers. So what can be done to avoid massive interferences due to lack of coordination in this area?
Well, I think when we speak about hybrid networks, it's important to clearly distinguish between two aspects. most of the hybrid networks that we see currently are, of course, combining terrestrial and satellite components, but they do that in different frequency bands. So the terrestrial part is in one frequency band, the satellite component is in another one. And as such, there is no interference coming up. Then there is a lot of interest into having true hybrid networks where both the terrestrial and space components would use the same band. And for example, you have in North America, the ATC, in Europe, the CGC, these complementary ground components, that are starting to be deployed. Up to now, there is not a large deployment, and therefore, it's difficult yet to assess whether there will be an increase of interference or not. In my personal view, as long as an hybrid network sharing the same frequency band has a kind of centralized control, the interference is manageable. If it really becomes operated by various providers in the same frequency band, then this may become more challenging, but it is currently not really foreseen in the next 5 to 10 years, because it would also imply to change radically the way you license spectrum in many countries. Because normally when you license spectrum in many countries, you license it for one user at a time.
I see, yeah. Well, we just talked about terrestrial networks. Let's go to Mars. So how do you see spectrum management occurring on the Moon and Mars and beyond?
Well, very good questions. Currently, we already have some provisions, mainly those that are devised for space research, say for all the space missions that the big space agencies are sending to launching to the outside to the deep space to study the solar system or the galaxy. So we already have some spectrum allocated for that, but not so much, it's true. We have also some provisions to protect the shielded zone of the Moon. So we have specific provisions to maintain the shielded zone of the Moon radio interference free. And of course, there is a network of space agencies, the Space Frequency Coordination Group, that ensure a coordination between all the space missions. Now, the big question for the future is what about the spectrum for the commercial space exploration? If the plans for commercial space exploration becomes reality, then there will not be enough bandwidth with the currently allocated spectrum. So we will need to search for additional spectrum for these kind of missions. And such work can start to be done in ITUR study group 7, which is one of the study groups that we have in ITU to deal with all scientific and research and scientific services. So this can be done. This is certainly going to be done based on the current foundation that we have. But probably maybe in the future we'll have radio regulation for the Moon and radio regulation for Mars. Who knows?
Wow. So Group 7 is going to be where it's at in the next few years, huh?
Yes.
That's great. Alexander, unfortunately, we are running out of time. I'd like to thank our guest, Alexander Vallee, Chief of the Space Services Department in the Radio Communication Bureau of the International Telecommunications Union, the ITU.
Thanks for listening to Constellations, the podcast from Kratos. If you like this interview, please subscribe, tell a friend, and give us a review.